We just ask, Father, that you open the eyes and ears of our heart, Father. Allow us to understand the words that you are speaking to us, Father, as we sit at the feet in your throne room of glory, Lord. We just ask, Father, that you would just bless us special, Father. Open up understanding, Father. We need to understand who you are in this time. And so, Father, we thank you, Lord. We love you and praise you. In your precious name we pray, Father. Amen. Again, we've been in this series that we started last week called In This Time, and I've explained to you that there is a spiritual battle going on above us, and as time draws to a close with God, which, you know, we no man knows the time or day, so don't get me wrong there, but as time begins to close, all right, and the Bible tells me that hearts will wax cold. As we begin to come to a close to this whole ridiculousness that's on right now, the spiritual battle above us draws closer to us, because at some point in time, that spiritual battle is going to be down here, all right? And that's what will be called Armageddon, all right? Because there will be spiritual warriors, there will be human warriors, there will just be tons and tons of people thrown into the mix. It ain't going to be pretty, all right? And so as we talk about being in this time right now, all right, we see this. And we can't, if you can't see what's going on today, then hopefully this message today will maybe give you a little glimpse or maybe wake you up a little bit, because there is some amazing stuff going on in the world today. All right. And in this amazing stuff we see, it only points towards the return of the Father at some point in time. At some point in time, God's going to say, hey, go get your children, because they can't play nice in the sandbox together. All right? And so in will come Jesus. He'll come down, and he will take his children home. And so in that, though, we've been given this time. All right? We have been given this time. And in this time, we have been given a task. So let's start off. I'm going to have you put your finger in Matthew 25, because that's the first place we're going to end up going. But I want to talk about the word circumspectly. And in Hebrew, all right, the word is akribos, all right, A-K-R-I-B-O-O-S, Shelley?
Yeah, A-K-R-I-B-O-O-S.
Okay, A-K-R-I-B-O-O-S, all right. And it means this, and I love this word, carefully, carefully, okay? So carefully means what? That we do things very carefully. We watch where we're walking. We watch what we're seeing. We watch what we're looking at. Basically, carefully means we are watching what the temple of God within us is allowed to have in it. That's first the word carefully. All right. And today, I mean, look at the news. All right. There is no carefulness on anything that's being said on the news today. All right. I mean, people are just throwing stuff back and forth and back and forth. And I don't think I've heard in any of the political debates anything about what anybody's going to do. Because they're too busy throwing insults back and forth at each other. And that's what's happening today. Insults are being boom, 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 constantly. So we're not being careful with the words we are speaking. We're not being careful with the things that we allow to enter into the temple of God, which sits here in our heart. The other word means is exactly. The other word that it means is exactly. So we have to be exact in what we allow into the temple. We have to be careful, but then we have to be exact in what we are allowing. Am I allowing the word of God to infiltrate my heart to the deepest, darkest depths, where the light will shine and drive out darkness? So we must be exact. Because see, first of all, we're not careful. Then we don't speak the exact words we're supposed to speak. And in not speaking the exact words we're supposed to speak, then we start being like every other person in the world today. And we are called to be above those people. As believers, we are called for a higher calling and a higher purpose than those that do not know Christ. You need to understand that. The next word is strictly. All right, so we must be strict. We must have a self I'm gonna try to make up a word.
Come on.
We must be self-strictifying in what we are hearing. Alright? Because remember, when we listen to stuff and we're not strict about what we listen to and what we read and what we watch and what we do this, if we're not strict about that, then we are allowing all sorts of garbage to enter in. And in that entering in, we are poisoning ourselves. And in that poisoning, we are not being exact about what we are saying or what we are doing, and we are not careful about what we allow to enter into the temple of God, which sits right here in the Zohar. So God gives us a certain amount of time in the day. And he's going to ask us, you know, and I know some people are like, oh, no, God's not going to ask me this question. Yeah, he is. When we get to heaven, God's going to ask you some questions. Your best friend, your BFF, ain't going to be standing next to you. Ain't going to happen. You ain't going to have a BFF. It's going to be you and the big dog. And he's going to look at you. And this is one of the questions he's going to ask. What did you do with the time I have given you? What did you do with the time I have given you? Can you respond as Christ did in John 17:4 when he said, I have glorified you on earth by accomplishing the work you gave me to do? See, when Christ went home to be with the Father, you know God asked him, but God knew, but God wanted to ask him, he said, what'd you do with the time I gave you? And Jesus said, I glorified you every waking moment that you allowed me to do. Every waking moment. I know that's scary for some of you, because you're going to say, oh God, I'm not quite sure, what did you do with the time that I gave you? If you go to Proverbs tells us, actually in Proverbs 16:28, it says, he's going to ask you that question, and you have to respond, did you spread strife? Did you separate friends? That's what God knows, but he's going to ask you that question. You need to understand that. Did you sow discord with the time that he gave you? In Psalm 108, verse 5, I believe, says, whoever slanders a neighbor secretly, God says, I will destroy and they will not endure. You need to understand. God does not think highly of wasting his time because he's called us for such a time as this. He didn't raise you up to just waste his time. That's why last week we said, hey, every morning we rise and shine and give God the glory. So we rise up. This is what God has told us to do. We rise up. God, bless my day today, Lord. Let me glorify you in all things, Father. Allow me to be a light that shines in a dark, dark place. Allow me to be a city on a hill. The next question God is going to ask you is this. What have you done with what I have given you? Now turn to Matthew 25. What have you done with what I have given you? You see, this funny thing happens. And I love the way that Jesus always used parables to explain what he was doing. All right, so in verse 14, I'm just going to kind of highlight it. The parable of the bags of gold. Because listen, what God has given you is more valuable than gold. But God used the illustration of a man with the gold bags, a very rich man. And this rich man was going on a journey. And so this rich man gave each person an amount of gold. So go to verse 15. It says, to one he gave 5 bags of gold, to another 2 bags, and to another one, 1 bag. Each according to his ability. Okay? Now, in the body of Christ, there are people that are here, 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 here. Everybody has a different ability that they are operating in the grace, mercy, wisdom, knowledge of who Jesus Christ is. All right? I was told by somebody once, how come you don't hold everybody to the same standard? I said, well, if I did, there'd be nobody in the church. There'd be nobody in church. Because if I had to hold everybody to this standard up here, there's nobody that jumped that bar. Nobody could jump that bar. Because why? Because we're all weak and frail. And because there are none righteous, no, not one. And if I have to hold the standard that the Pharisees and the Sadducees held for believers, we would never be where we are today. Okay? So you need to understand that. Each person, in their ability, God gives what they can handle. You need to understand that. But you're going to find that there will be some that want everybody held up here. But not even they can be held to this standard. And so in that standard, they wouldn't make it either. So here's God. Here's Christ telling the story. And he says, the man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 more bags. What did you do with the time I have given you? What have you done with what I have given you? So this man put those 5 bags to work and gained 5 bags more. He invested and reaped what his investment was, which is 5 times more than he had. So also, the next person, the one with 2 bags of gold, gained 2 more. But the man who had received 1 bag went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. In other words, what God had given him to hand out, he never handed out. He just kept it inside. And as he kept it inside, he never invested it, never gave it out, never gave it away. He hid it. It's like knowing Christ and never allowing him to shine. So listen. Because this all goes with the message. Alright? So after a long time, the master of these servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received 5 bags of gold brought the other 5. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 5 bags of gold. See, I have gained 5 more. In other words, I invested it. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. What have you done with my time? Master, every day I woke up and I went out and I shined my life that you have given me to others. And I invested. And look, look at my investment. From the throne comes, well done, good and faithful. Well done, good, faithful servant. You see, Jesus is telling the story here of what happens when you're going to stand before his Father. What have you done with what I have given you? Have you invested it, or have you squandered it? So, the next guy comes up, and he goes, oh, the man with 2 bags of gold came. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 2 bags of gold. See, I have gained 2 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. He said that to the first gentleman, too. I'll put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Then the man who had received 1 bag of gold came. Master, he said, I knew that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your gold in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. Well, then you should have put my money on deposit with the banker so that when I returned, I would have at least
received it back with interest. So take the bag of gold from him and give it to the one who has 10 bags, for whoever has will be given more. So whoever has will be given more. Oh, Pastor Mark, I want to be in charge of something. This is where the word fruit comes to play. What is your investment then? What is your investment then? As I've said before, I was given a key when I first started returning to God from being stupid. I thought I needed more. I thought I deserved more. But my pastor in his wisdom goes, here's a key. I go, what's the key to? It's to the building. He goes, no, it's that great arch caravan out there. And that's what your mission field is. And in that mission field, Lisa's sitting here. And Lisa has become a good friend. And Lisa's like my sister. And her daughters are like my daughters. Sister. And whenever Lisa calls, because she knows I have been faithful with what I've been given, she knows she can call and get answers. See, the investment in the time is what God looks at. And all her children are saved. Every single one of her children belong to Jesus Christ. All because I was given a key to drive a vehicle to pick up a family, a mom and her daughters and her boys. I could have said, it's a key and I'm not doing this. But see, now, because of that, God is opening brand new doors for this church every day in amazing ways. Because I'm not afraid to invest. See, in this time right now, it is so important to invest in things. It is unimportant to waste time. Because in wasting time, we take our eyes off of Him. Like I said three or four Sundays before, if this is not correct, vertical with God, then none of this will ever be correct. No matter what you do, no matter what you say, no matter what you invest in, if this is not correct, this will never be correct. And the Word of God tells me that. So, God is going to ask those two questions. Did you walk carefully? Now, carefully in the Hebrew word is shamar. All right, going to be a lot of Hebrew today, Shelley. All right. And that is S-H-A-M-A-R. And it means to keep watch and preserve. To keep watch and preserve. I've been called to be the watchman over this church. Some people don't like my decision sometimes. That's too bad. Because my decisions come after prayer. I don't do anything without praying. The Word of God tells me to take everything before the throne room of glory, so that's where I need to take it. And then I find resolve for situations from God. I've said that since day one. He speaks to me. He always has. He hasn't stopped, and He always will. And so in that, I handle things with God being the first that I go to. Now, sometimes people don't like those answers. And the enemy hates those answers because he loves to do what he does. And that's okay because he's going to lose the battle. The Word of God says so. And I believe the Word of God. In the end, he doesn't win. But he's doing everything in his power today to have us take such a time as this, in this time, and daze and confuse us from staying true to God's call on our life. And so he creates distractions. Now, let me ask you something, or let me go on here. So it says, keep watch and preserve. Do you keep watch and preserve the things that God gave you? His word, his commands, and his life-giving light. Do you live in the holiness that he has called you to? Remember, he has called you to live as Christ. And in Christ, we are dead to sin, but alive in him. So what does that mean? What is sin? Anything outside of the will of God. That's sin. If you read Romans will tell you exactly what sin is. And it basically says anything outside of God's will is sin. Period. End of conversation. So how can you argue sin? Especially if sin is anything outside the will of God. Unless you're living outside the will of God. Then you'll put up an argument for sin. And you notice what that just did? It distracted you from living in the time that God has given you that is precious. Because this time we're living in is precious right now. It is precious. Let's keep going. So, remember, he has called you to live as Christ, and in Christ we are dead to sin, but alive in him. In Romans 6:11, that's where that's found. The word exactly is adrazda, A-D-R-A-Z-D-A. And I love this word because it means with zeal. With zeal. If you look at Christianity today, a number of people that have said, I live for Christ, have no zeal. No zeal, no enthusiasm, no excitement. I can't wait to bust out of bed. And I'm already praising God for the day. No matter what comes, I'm like, all right, God, we're good. We're ready to go. Nothing's going to distract me, although I know the enemy's going to throw every bit of garbage he can at me. But my focus is on the ring. My focus is on the prize. And nothing's going to stop me from keeping my vertical with you, even though I know the enemy's going to do it. Let's get it on. Those are my words. But how many people get up and do this? Oh. Oh, what's he going to give me today? Oh. There's no vim or vigor in her steps. And goes, what's your issue? I haven't even done anything yet and you're already complaining. Why don't you look up at me instead of looking down at the ground or horizontal to everybody else? Look at me because I have something special in this time. Do you know that when we blow off time, we can't go back and retain that time? Because what happens is every single thing that happened in that time, so just saying, had I not taken that key, Lisa wouldn't be here. All of her kids wouldn't be saved. Corianne would still be out, well, probably dead. Corianne would be dead because of drug abuse. And all her other beautiful young daughters would be running, doing whatever they did. All because I would have said no and not said yes in the time that God called me to be in. See, I can only use my life as illustrations because I'm not going to use other people's lives. Well, I'm using Lisa, but Lisa's given me permission to do this. Think about that. Kind of. I love Lisa and her family. And the word zeal is zelos. And it means with enthusiasm. So many have lost that enthusiasm that comes with a life with Christ. Please turn to Psalm 100. I love the Psalms. Psalm 100 is especially amazing. And I will tie this all up to end this time in a minute. But I need to paint this picture. So Psalm 100, verse 1, and that's where we're going to start because we can't start anywhere else because we're already starting at number 1, says this, shout for joy to the Lord. The first word being shout. The third word being joy. So shout joy to the Lord, all the earth. There's a song that says, shout for joy, all you people. And then I can't remember the rest of it because, where's Fred? Clap your hands, all you people. Shout for the joy in a voice of triumph.
Yeah.
There it is.
Okay.
In a voice of triumph. Okay. So let me ask you something. Are you triumphant today? Thank you, Josiah. Are you triumphant today? Are you triumphant in the things that God has called you to do? Or are you trying to validate the things that you didn't do because you didn't feel like it? I love Josh's daughter when she yells amen because she's triumphant. She doesn't even know she's triumphant. She just knows she's joyful. And she shouts it out, amen. She was a little girl that came up here and tried to bribe me with a dollar. But she's triumphant. See? She's not trying to validate what she's doing or who she is. She's just saying amen. God wants us to have that childlike faith and say amen. Amen. God, whatever you got for me, amen. Yay and amen. M&M's. Just do that. Shout for joy. The next verse, it says, worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. How in the world can complaints be joyful songs? They can't. They're not. I love when music, praise God. When they should be yelling, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for every single thing. You know, again, I love running to the fire. I love running to the fire. Because the fire is where I get to dance with Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, for the fire. Amen, hallelujah, Father, for every situation that's coming my way. Because I get to shine your glory in it. Your glory, not mine. Not I, me, or mine. Your glory. Every single bit of who I am belongs to you. And you have made me who I am. And I will give you an everlasting joy in it. Know the Lord is God in verse 3. There's no gladness today. There's no gladness. And it's because we've been wrapped up with the horizontal rather than the vertical. Now the word strictly in the Hebrew is osparna, O-S-P-A-R-N-A, and it means diligently, with great care. So how carefully do you consider the word of God today? Are you just like applying the only parts that apply to you that validate sin and give you a reason to justify sin through grace and mercy, which means that you're now using grace and mercy as a license to sin? Are you very careful about the Word of God? Are you looking at the Word of God and saying, wow, I've got to live by that? Because one day God is going to ask me what I did with what he has given me. And he's going to say, what have you done with what I've given you? And then he's going to do this. He's going to open his word. And he's going to go, here's what my word says you should have done. And then he's going to hit with his remote. And he's going to pop your story up. And he's going to say, where does that match up with this? Think about that for a minute. Where does that match up with this? Because honestly, we can change and switch the word of God to say whatever we want it to say to validate whatever we're doing. We can. But when you're standing in front of God, how are you going to validate and change his word when he wrote it? You're not. You can't. You won't. He's not going to let you. He's going to say, this is what I've said. This is what you did. How do they match? How do they match? He said, I gave you something to do in a time frame. And then I gave you scripture to back it up. I gave you my word to back it up. What have you done? How do you come up with an excuse for God or to God to validate walking outside of his word? You can't. So how carefully do we consider the word of God today? Is it just a passing thing, or is it what your life depends on? And do you protect it carefully as it settles into your heart and becomes part of your life? Do you carefully guard your heart? Do you diligently study the Word so that your head is covered by the Word of God? Now, we've been given a certain time to walk the walk that we have. And the word walk in the Hebrew has two different meanings. The first one is halak, H-A-L-A-K. All right, I'm throwing Hebrew at you today because I need you to understand it. And the word halak means go. When Jesus told his disciples, go, he said halak into the world, go into the world. I'm giving you a time frame to go, save the lost, baptize those people, heal those people, allow them to see the glory of God within you. In other words, he said, let your actions speak louder than your words. I almost think God at times really goes, why to give them mouths? Why to give them mouths? They just don't know how to use them. Because they constantly Lord, help us. I mean, we watch it. We've watched all the insults being thrown back and forth and back and forth and over and under and left and right and in and out. All these words being thrown against the Word of God. Against the Word of God. And then we go, Lord, why aren't you blessing me? And he goes, why aren't you speaking my language? Why aren't you speaking my language? My language edifies, builds up. Doesn't tear down, doesn't destroy. I've given you a time to reveal who I am. But yet you have put me away. The word halak also means, and the second meaning of it is mahalak, M-A-H-A-L-A-K. And it means journey. So God has called us on a journey. Now earlier in the message we spoke about time and what you do with the time Jesus has given you. Now, Paul took this topic on with great, great enthusiasm. Because if you read Paul, you can any of the letters Paul wrote, you can see his enthusiasm for serving God in the time that he was in. I mean, Paul went to great lengths to serve God. Paul could have done a number of things because, now, let's see, Paul was arrested. He was dipped in burning oil. Paul had a ton of stuff done to him. But not once did Paul say, "I'm really pissed off." Everybody said, "Did he just use that word?" Yes, he did. Paul never got mad. He never got pissed off. He never complained. He never whined. He never cried. He never did this. You know what Paul did? "I count it an honor to serve my God. And whatever I go through is nothing compared to what Christ went through." Paul was enthusiastic. Even though he was being chained up, he was being thrown in jail, and he had all this stuff happening in his life. Paul was enthusiastic about serving God. Great illustration in the Word of God on what we should be doing. Paul saw so many believers wasting precious time, being concerned with unconcernable things. So one of the things with having a correct walk with God is knowing how to handle time. So in other words, you need to know time management. "Pastor Mark, no man knows the time." That's right. You're absolutely right. No man knows the time. So here's what you do. Live it as if it's your last day. The Word of God tells me that, to live every day as if it's your last. Don't be concerned with time and what's going on with time right now. Be concerned with Christ and when he may say, "Time to come home." That's what your concern is. So, uh-oh, Evan's not happy. So listen, as we go on. So in Nehemiah, all right, Nehemiah had been a cupbearer for King whatever his name is. Xerxes, that's it, there you go. All right. He had been a cupbearer for Xerxes. And he prayed to God because he saw the trouble in Jerusalem. He saw that the wall had come down. He saw all these things happening. And so Nehemiah began to pray. He didn't run around going, "Oh my God, this is going on." He went, "Lord, give me an opportunity. Give me an opportunity to make it right." And then he did this. He repented of his sin. And God said, "Okay, Nehemiah, guess what? I'm going to allow you to go back to Jerusalem as a governor." So Xerxes comes up and says, "Nehemiah, go back to Jerusalem." But see, Xerxes was so worried that Nehemiah wouldn't come back. Xerxes says, "So when will you be back? Or will you return?" And Nehemiah goes, "Yes, I will." Nehemiah didn't have to return, but he was honoring God, who had honored his prayer of redemption and repentance and allowed him to go build a wall and save his people. Now listen, I want to tell you what happens when you have God. So Nehemiah confessed what he had done, redeemed the time, he had been away from God. So listen, before you have a correct walk, you have to correct the walk you've been walking. That's a tongue tie right there. You have to correct the off walk with God. So how can we make the most out of every opportunity when we are not walking? Here it comes. Carefully, exactly, and correctly. With zeal and enthusiasm, using great care with what we have been given, walking and going on this amazing journey of faith God has given us. We need to be very careful. Now, the word shamar in the Hebrew means to keep. S-H-A-M-A-R means to keep. And it means to keep the time the Lord has given us. There's one guy assigned to Big Ben in England. A big clock tower. That's his job. He watches that clock like this. And if it even is close to being off, he has to go up the tower and adjust it and make it right. He's a keeper of time. That's what he does. Are you a keeper of the time God gave you? Are you a keeper of the time God gave you? Or do you just look at the clock and go, yeah, there's plenty of time. I was speaking to a gentleman on his deathbed. And I walked into the room and he said, Pastor Mark, I'm so upset. I go, why? He said, I thought I had all the time in the world. He said, I have no time. How do I make it right? I said, you can't. He said, you can. I said, but what you can do is say, forgive me, Father. Because I have not been a good steward of the time you have given me in the journey you have allowed me to walk in. He looked at me and said, what's that going to do? I said, it's going to be God forgiving you, redeeming your time, and allowing you to be with him. Right after he prayed that, he took a breath and he passed away. And then he stood before the Father. And I can almost see him standing there going, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. I wasted what you have given me. There's no excuse. There's really no excuse. Because if we honor God, we honor his word. We honor his word. The time the Lord has given us, you know there's not much time, I believe, left. And again, I've said this before, I do believe we are hearing the clock tick ever closer to God, calling his children home. Am I going to become nervous? Absolutely not. Nope, not at all. Am I going to hoard stuff and stick it in my basement? Nope. Am I going to hide? Nope. And it's because I've been given an incredible journey and I've been called to go. Wherever, whenever God may call me. You see, we need to be very careful that we hear God calling us to go. That's that carefully, exactly, strictly thing. We are to be very careful that we're not listening to something else tell us that it's time to go and do other things. I've watched a lot of pastors. A lot of great men and women of God make decisions that were not based on the word of God, but based on emotion. And emotion has led them to some very bad places. I've seen marriages destroyed. I've seen lives destroyed. I've seen homes destroyed because a decision was made that was not from God. You need to be very careful. The Bible says to test everything against the Word of God. Not your acknowledgement of the Word of God, but by the Word of God. And in this time, I will tell you, where this spiritual battle here is inching ever closer to him, handed to humanity here, we need to be very careful on how we interpret or self-interpret God's Word. Matter of fact, the Word of God says to not self-interpret His Word. And so we need to be very careful as this comes down to here and we don't get ensnared. Because remember, the Word of God tells me that Satan sets a snare for those to entrap them. It's what he does. The Word of God talks about this. And right now the snares are set at a ground level. And he's laying waste to people. Oh, he does make it sound sweet. It's like having a poopsicle in chocolate. Everybody just want to never eat any of those anymore. So, one of the most amazing things we can do as a believer is learn time management. In Psalm 139:16, it tells me that God has prepared a journey for me. Long before I was formed, my time was well planned and grafted to fit what I have been called for. So why do I waste what precious little time I have? Remember, the moments you waste and let go will never be back. They are gone. So we must be careful in how we walk, where we walk, and the time it takes to walk there. Again, Nehemiah 2:6, the king asked Nehemiah how long he would be gone. And Nehemiah set a time. Do you know to build the wall that surrounded Jerusalem took 25 days? For us to build a little wall in our yard takes 6 months. I'm looking at John, who's got to build horse things. You probably say, John, how long is that going to take you? I have no idea. See, God has a set time for things. God has a set time. And can you imagine building a wall? Now, if you knew how tall this wall was and how wide it was, you would go, 25 days, oh my God. I want those guys working with me. But it took 25 days to build the wall. And it took 12 years to rebuild the city of Jerusalem. In which time Nehemiah returned. See, he kept his word. He kept his word. I'm sure it wasn't easy to return. And I know it wasn't easy to build the wall. There was resistance. But Nehemiah was focused on his walk. And so when we stand before God, he's going to say, "Were you focused like Nehemiah?" And there's Nehemiah standing there going, "Remember me? Took me 25 days to build a wall. I was focused. Are you focused? Are you focused?" You see, in such a time as this, God needs us to be focused. He doesn't need us to be wandering to and fro looking for the next best thing that's going to bring us to an emotional satisfaction for a second, only to leave that and go to something else for another second. The Word of God describes that. It's what happens to us. It's what happens in our Adam nature. We go, ooh, ooh. It's like being given a penny and going into a penny candy store with 10,000 pieces of candy. You're going to run from counter to counter to counter to counter to counter to counter looking for something that you want, and you're never going to be satisfied. And only one penny buys one piece of candy. But Nehemiah was focused on his walk, and he did it with enthusiasm, with great care, because he knew he had a certain amount of time to complete the work. The Word of God tells me to run the good race again, good being the best with what God has given me. And what was the best? Jesus Christ in his sacrificial death and resurrection. If we are to be like Christ, we are to take the time the Father has given us and not be distracted in our call from God. Remember Lazarus? He's the dude that died. Great friend of Jesus, close friend of Jesus. And so Lazarus died, and Mary and Martha come running up and say, "Jesus, Lazarus died." And Jesus goes, "No, he's just sleeping. He'll be okay." This is a personal friend of his. Close personal friend. And Mary's like, Martha's like, "What?" And Jesus goes, "Yeah, he's sleeping. I've got to finish what I'm doing. And then I'll take care of him." 3 days later, Jesus goes to find Lazarus, finds him in a tomb. Walks in. He says, "Get up." Lazarus gets up and goes, "Wow, I needed that rest." walks out of the cave. And everybody goes, oh my gosh.
He's alive.
Absolutely. Absolutely. See, even Christ, and you're probably going to say, well, you know, he's the Son of God. See, everybody's got an argument for everything. Well, he's the Son of God. Never became distracted on his journey that he was called to be on. Never was distracted. Walked where God needed him to go at that specific time, in the time of his call. And then God said, okay, it's time to go here. Crickets. So not even the death of Lazarus, who was Jesus' great friend, distracted Jesus from the Father's call. So we need to be like-minded as Christ and walk without distraction, with excitement and care to finish the race in the time frame we have been allotted in our journey. Though only God knows the time, although a lot of people think they know the time, no man knows the time. So no one knows the time, but the word says we must live each day as it is our last. Every day is a gift. Are you living in the gift you have been given? Are you living in the gift you have been given? See, that's the most important thing. Are you living in the gift that God has given you? You know, I'm not going to let people distract me. I'm not going to let circumstances distract me. God has given me a journey to be on. And my journey is to go out and reveal the life of Christ to those that are lost. That is my journey. My journey is to be the pastor of this church and to be a watchman. I'm a watchman. But I am never going to reveal everything I've got going on in this church with different people, because I am not going to take the ball and raise it here because somebody wants it raised there. Because if I do, nobody will be in this church. Because there are none worthy, no, not one. And there are none righteous, no, not one. And we are all sinners saved by grace that stumble along this walk and make mistakes, have to give up, get dusted off, put bandages on our bruised knees, and casts on our broken wrists. I'm putting that in for my mom. You know, and it's just the way it's going to be. That's why my mom's not here. She, you know, she did her wrist and her knee did something the other day. I said, you're getting old. I said, welcome to the club. I said, my body hurts all the time. Don't let it be your focus. But if I raise this bar up here, there ain't none of us going to be able to be here. Because nobody's going to be able to jump over, including me. Getting this mass to go over that bar ain't going to happen. Right, this isn't going to work. I used to be able to jump. Can't jump no more. So think about that. Don't let stuff take your focus away from who Christ has called you to be in this time. Rise and shine and give God the glory every single day. Please bow your heads and close your eyes. This is an amazing series, and I know God is doing something phenomenal in it. I know that there's a blessing just around the corner. As a matter of fact, I'm very positive there's a blessing, because I know some things that are going on that we've been asked to be involved in. So with every head bowed and every eye closed, we've talked about time. We've talked about God giving you a journey to go on. We've talked about, you know, the things he has called you to do in such a time as this. Well, maybe you don't even know who Jesus Christ is, and maybe you have never heard of the time, and maybe you've never experienced the journey, and maybe you've never, you know, had that opportunity to say, wow, I have wasted a lot of time. But I want to give you an opportunity to redeem that today. I want you to have an opportunity to step out in faith and trust God with all things. And the start to that is this. Father, come into my heart, save me, Lord. I'm a sinner. And Father, my life is not what you want it to be. And And so, Lord, Father, come into my heart and save me, Father. Redeem me, forgive me, and set me on a new path. Set me on a new path. Father, come into my heart and live. Come into my heart and live. Now, with every head bowed and every eye closed, maybe you've never said that prayer before. Maybe you've never asked Jesus Christ to be a part of your life. Maybe you're just walking through time. And you go, what's my purpose? But that prayer will set you free. So if that was your prayer today, if you ask Christ to become part of your life, to lead you on a journey, to redeem your time, then here's what I want you to do. I just want you to lift up your hand real quick and put it back down if you received Christ. Nobody's looking at me. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Father God, you see the hands, Lord. You see the hands, Father. Anybody else? Father, we thank you, Lord Jesus. We love you, Father. We ask, Lord, that you would honor these people, Father. Bless them special in amazing ways, Father. Show them the journey in the time frame that you have given them. So, Father, we just thank you, Lord. We love you and we praise you, Father. In your precious name we pray, Lord. Amen. If you're a visitor for the first time here, if you just